they're pretty good.
It's over there.
Today, how delighted we are to be in this house gathered with God's people. Often we'll use the term God's house. I just want to make sure that everybody understands what we mean by that when we say that. It's not like this is the place where God lives, or that when we leave, we had a children's book that when our children were really little, and it was talking about when we go to church. When we leave church, we say, by God. Bye-bye, God. No, we don't. We don't. And we had to correct that little bit of mistaken theology. But no, when we leave, if we are believers, we are the church of living stones. Come together as his body to sing his praises, to be a demonstration of his glory, and he lives in us, as it were. And so that's what we mean by that. That part is free, by the way. That wasn't even a part of the sermon. So as we gather here, I just want to say welcome. You are welcome in this place. And if you are a guest with us particularly, we want to say thank you for being here. And it's our custom to take bulletin in hand and or worship folder in hand and to tear off the perforated section of that. So if you would do that with me. And once again, if you are here for the first time or the first time in a long time, then we have opportunity for you to share that with us, share your information with us on one side of that. We would ask that you to do that. And then on the back side is a place to record any decisions or requests for information or anything else that you would like to share on that part. And then you can either give that to me at the end of the service or you can drop it in the box at the back. It's marked tithe/offering box. I'll just mention that when we came back after we had been not meeting for several Sundays, we decided not to pass the plate. And so there is a place for you to place any tithes or offerings that you may come prepared to give at the rear. And you can also place these little cards there if you so choose. All right. Our call to worship this morning is Psalm 105, 1 through 6. Before we say that, I want to say if at the end of the service, we want you to greet those around you. We want you to greet those, especially who you know, maybe you haven't seen before in a long time, and just be, you know, be respectful of distance and that kind of thing. We're kind of, in some ways, I feel like maybe we're past that. In some ways, we don't know. So just be cognizant of maybe how other people are thinking, feeling about that. But we do want to encourage you to spend time in conversation at the end of the service and greeting especially. So Psalm 105, verses 1 through 6. Why don't we read these words together from God's Word? Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon His name. Make known His deeds among the peoples. Sing to Him. Sing praises to Him. Tell of all His wondrous works. Glory in His holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord and His strength. Seek His presence continually. Remember the wondrous works that He has done, His miracles and the judgments He uttered. O offspring of Abraham, His servant, children of Jacob, His chosen ones. Let's pray together. Our Father and our God, we come on this Lord's Day to recognize You, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. And so, Lord, we pray that our worship would be acceptable to You as we offer it to You, Father, through the finished work of Your Son, the Lord Jesus. And in the power and the grace of Your Holy Spirit operating in our lives. Lord, we acknowledge You to be the Lord. And we ask that these moments might be sacred and set apart for You. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. God. Amen. Would you stand together? Everything that happens in this room today and everything that happens in your life, we want to do the honor and glory of God, and so we're going to sing to the King this morning.
Is empire shall breathe. sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who leaves the power with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place.
Solomon said, "You have shown great and steadfast love to your servant David, my father, because he walked before you in faithfulness, in righteousness, in uprightness of heart toward you. And you have kept for him this great and steadfast love and given him a son to sit on his throne this day. And now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of me, David, my father. Although I am but a little child, I do not know how to come out or go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of your people whom you have chosen, a great people, too many to be numbered or counted for multitude. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to govern this your great people? It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this, and God said to him, because you have asked this, and have not asked for yourself long life or riches or the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, behold, I now do according to your word. Behold, I give you a wise and discerning mind, so that none like you has been before you, and none like you shall rise after you. In the New Testament, Romans chapter 8, verses 26 through 39. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for all of us, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, he was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of God? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long, and we are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen. Those final words bring such comfort to our hearts as believers that nothing is able to separate us from the love of God as it is in Christ Jesus our Lord. How much is nothing? Have you thought about ever trying to describe that? It's the absence. It isn't a something. It's the absence of everything. So there is literally no gap between those of us who have been saved by Christ and Christ himself. We are in union with him. And in union with him, we approach the throne of grace this morning. In preparation for a time of prayer, we want to extend our Christian sympathy to Diana Wright in the loss of her brother this week. And so we pray for her family, extended family as well, in a pastoral way. But we come at this time primarily for the purpose of confessing our sins as a people. This is something that we do corporately, because we ought to have been doing it individually through the week. If you find yourself thinking, well, I wait till Sunday to confess my sins to the Lord and seek forgiveness and cleansing, just be thinking, that's probably too long a time to let go by between the sin and the confession of it. Part of it has to do with the fact that if you're like me, your forgetter is better than your rememberer. And it's easy to forget those faults and those failings. So better to keep that account short with the Lord. So we come to the Lord this morning as his people, coming to confess sins as to a father, a loving father, no longer our judge in the sense of condemnation, because all the condemnation has fallen on Christ, and it's because of Him now that we can come as forgiven children. But if you have yet to put your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, then this time of confession really should be a time for you to consider Christ and consider Him in all His fullness and consider yourself as a sinner in need of a Savior and come to Him for the first time in faith and repentance, trusting Him. That's the first order of business. We say this quite often, and so we wouldn't want to be confused about that or confusing. When we come to this time of confession, this is a time when believers confess and receive cleansing for those individual transgressions and sins. So let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. You may choose to adopt a posture in prayer that reflects your heart, and that could be sitting, it could be standing, it could be kneeling. So would you join me as we go to the Lord in prayer this morning? Our Father and our God, we have magnified You in praise today. We have sung our hallelujahs. We have sung our praise the Lord's. We have confessed, Lord, that it is You, the Almighty One who reigns. We have sung to the King who is coming to reign. We have sung of the amazing love and the amazing grace of You, Lord, in salvation. We have heard Your word read today. And in so doing, we have sought to obey what Your word tells us, to give attention to the reading of the word. So we thank You that we have that opportunity. Unlike many generations of Christians before us who didn't have a Bible in their own language. And unlike many Christians around the world, even today, who are prohibited from seeing or hearing or learning the Word of God. Father, we pray for the persecuted church today. In places all around the world, we pray for the persecuted church in China particularly today. And we ask that You would grant Your grace to those courageous believers who week by week meet often in secret, and how the church is thriving and growing there. We pray for continued growth and life there, not necessarily the end of all persecution, for we know that the blood of the martyrs is the seed of Your church. Lord, we come to You as sinners who have been justified. This is a deep irony that we are both justified and sinners at the same time. But You have done it, Lord. You no longer see us in our sin. You see us through the Lord Jesus Christ. And yet we have faults, failings. We have transgressions and sins that we want to bring before You today, because we know what You have given us in Your word, in Your law. When You said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might." And these words that I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children. Talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way, when you lie down and when you rise. Lord, we see a picture of discipleship there, family discipleship. But we also see how we have fallen short of that glory. Christ has accomplished it all on our behalf. So we pray that as we approach You through the finished work of Christ, that You would forgive and cleanse. We know that we have that promise from Your word. As we boldly approach Your throne of grace to receive mercy in our time of need, that You will grant it. And that is what we ask for today. Thank You for granting it to us, Lord. Father, we just take a moment and confess individually. agreeing with you that sin is sin and in need of forgiveness and cleansing. Now, Lord, we pray on behalf of our congregation today. Lord, we pray for those who have lost loved ones. Father, we pray especially for Russ and Diana today and the loss of Diana's brother. We ask that you would bring comfort and consolation to them in the midst of their grief and sorrow. Perhaps there are others, Lord, that we know not of, and we ask that you would come alongside them, console them by the power of your Spirit. Now, Lord, we offer up our prayer to you in the precious and the strong and the holy name, which is above every name, the name of Jesus. And for his sake, we pray. Amen. Hear these words of forgiveness and pardon, wonderful words that have meant so much to believers down through the years from Paul's epistle to the Romans when he wrote in chapter 8, "There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." Amen. Amen.
Forever, author of salvation, he
rose and he conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Jesus is mighty to save, and those who have experienced that salvation know that deeply and intimately and personally. And so I encourage you, if you know the Lord Jesus, if you have experienced that depth of salvation, share that with someone. Tell them about it this week. This morning is going to be a little bit different in that we don't have a single passage of Scripture that we'll be giving an exposition of, but several passages that we'll be referring to. It's more of a doctrinal sermon. It's more of a focusing in on a specific teaching of Scripture. And so the Bible is not an encyclopedia of texts that you just go to and, oh, here's the text on the church, here's the text on salvation, but rather it is a book of redemption, and you find the thread of redemption through that in multiple ways. And this morning we're going to be looking at the subject, what are the marks of a gospel church? The marks of a gospel church. So have your copy of the Scriptures handy. We will be looking at several passages. You may not be able to turn to every one of them, but we will seek to give you opportunity to do that. Well, it was the 60s, the 1560s. It had only been 50 years or so, maybe a little bit better than that, since Luther had nailed his 95 theses to the Wittenberg church door in Wittenberg, Germany. The Netherlands at that time was just known as Belgica. We get our word Belgium from the southern part of that those lowlands. It was known as that, but they were under the domination of King Philip II of Spain. Protestants were suffering greatly under a persecuting hand, under this Roman Catholic monarch. And in an effort to appeal to Philip's Christian conscience, the Dutch Reformed drew up a confession of faith. And it was known as the Belgic Confession. And they did it partly to show Philip that they indeed were true Christians, simply trying to live according to Scripture under the lordship of Jesus Christ and the dictates of their Christian conscience. And so they sent him a copy. About a year after they drew it up, they sent him a copy of this, along with an address in which the petitioners declared this, that they were ready to obey the government in all lawful things. So this is a Romans 13 kind of approach. We're ready to obey the government in all lawful things, but they would, quote, offer their backs to stripes, their tongues to knives, their mouths to gags, and their whole bodies to fire, rather than deny the truth expressed in this confession. Well, Philip, would anyone care to guess what Philip did? Well, he promptly ignored this plea for clemency, but the product of their labors lived on, and it became an important document for Christians for hundreds of years, even up to this day. And Article 29 of that confession, I think there's 37 articles total in it, and if you don't know what a confession of faith is, it's like an abbreviated systematic theology. These are the things that we believe the Scripture teaches and that we believe. It's a little bit similar to a creed, but it's a little bit more in depth than that. And a little bit more specific on some things. So Article 29 is entitled The Marks of the True and the False Church. And even that word, even that phrase might be striking and startling to us. That there is a true church and there's a false church. How many know that that's the case? It is the case. There are true. We might better say that there are true churches of Jesus Christ and there are false churches. So it's worth reading in its entirety, if you will indulge me. The language, thankfully, has been updated since the 1560s. Of course, it was likely written in Latin then, so this is an English translation. Here's how it goes. We believe that we ought to discern diligently and very carefully by the word of God what is the true church. For all the sects in the world today claim for themselves the name of, quote, the church. We're not speaking here of the company of hypocrites who are mixed among the good in the church and who nonetheless are not part of it, even though they're physically there. So here their understanding is that there are people physically in the visible church that are not part of the spiritual church, the true church. But we are speaking of distinguishing the body and fellowship of the true church from all sects, S-E-C-T-S, that call themselves the church. The true church can be recognized if it has the following marks, and here's where we get the title for our message. Number one, the church engages in the pure preaching of the gospel. Number two, it makes use of the pure administration of the sacraments as Christ instituted them. We would refer to this as ordinances, but they refer to it as sacraments. Number three, it practices church discipline for correcting faults. In short, it governs itself according to the pure word of God, rejecting all things contrary to it and holding Jesus Christ as the only head. By these marks, one can be assured of recognizing the true church, and no one ought to be separated from it. As for those who are of the church, we can recognize them by the distinguishing marks of Christians, namely by faith and by their fleeing from sin and pursuing righteousness once they have received the one and only Savior, Jesus Christ. They love the true God and their neighbors without turning to the right or left. And they crucify the flesh and its works. Though great weakness remains in them, they fight against it by the Spirit all the days of their lives, appealing constantly to the blood, suffering, death, and obedience of the Lord Jesus. Oh, this is so critical, because it would be very easy for us to be, you know, just laying a burden of law down, but no, it is by faith. In whom they have forgiveness of their sins through faith in him. As for the false church, it assigns more authority to itself and its ordinances than to the word of God. It does not want to subject itself to the yoke of Christ. It does not administer the sacraments as Christ commanded in his word. It rather adds to them or subtracts from them as it pleases. That's a reference to what was going on in the medieval church at the time. They had multiplied like seven sacraments instead of the two. It bases itself on men more than on Jesus Christ. It persecutes those who live holy lives according to the word of God and who rebuke it for its faults, greed, and idolatry. These two churches are easy to recognize and thus to distinguish from each other. That's Article 29 of the Belgic Confession. Now, it's hard for us to appreciate just how revolutionary these words were. And they were. We're talking about just 40-some years into the work of the Reformation. And so it's still in its infancy. But it's hard for us to imagine just how revolutionary and how striking these words were as we sit here in the relative comfort and ease of these palatial confines by comparison, unmolested by the iron fist of a hostile government. We're unhindered by the fear of reprisal from a secret police or from violent protesters or rioters or mobs coming after us. We don't worry about those things. But we are very much unlike most of the Church of Jesus Christ for most of its existence. Dare I say it, we have become complacent in our freedom. We take it absolutely for granted. How thankful we are for it. But may we never, ever forget the price paid to secure it. We sit here today because of the men who fought, bled, and died for freedom. May we never surrender that willingly. May we never, ever forget it. And yet, for most of the church's existence, that has not been the case. Most of the church has lived under some level of persecution, at least from time to time, and then there have been times of peace. So you have to know, though, about the state of affairs in the medieval church. It was decidedly unbiblical. It was decidedly unspiritual, worldly, and wicked. And if we have time today, we'll describe a little bit more of that a little later on. But just know that the church, the medieval church, the institutional church, what we would call the Roman Catholic Church today, was very, very worldly, very much opposed to the gospel of Jesus Christ, very much opposed to these things, the preaching of the word, the pure administration of the sacraments without adding all kinds of ceremonies and rituals to that, and then the true discipline of the church. Rather than exercising true scriptural discipline, what did they do? It was arbitrary discipline, and it was punishment, often based on what people would do to go against the church in favor of the scripture. They didn't want the scripture to be the standard. And so the framers of this confession knew what they were up against. That's why these are called three marks of the true church and not three marks of the ideal church. I've entitled it three marks of a gospel church, but gospel church and true church are synonyms here. Not even three marks of a healthy church. You know, there's books out there called Nine Marks of a Healthy Church, and we've looked at those, and they're wonderful things, but what really constitutes a church of the Lord Jesus Christ is when these three things are present, these three marks. Without these, we can say with a good deal of certainty that without these, you do not have a true church of Jesus Christ. So to say these marks are important is really a gross understatement. They really are indispensable. So let's consider each one of these along with scriptural support for each one. And the first mark, and I've given them to you in your outline, I would ask that you follow along with that. That helps you to kind of figure out where we are. And if I mention a scripture, it's usually going to be printed in the guide. And so just follow along. And if you want to make notes, you can. I would encourage you to do so. The first mark is the pure preaching of the gospel. Now, this should be completely without controversy for us today. That's what we would stand upon. That's what we would believe in. The primary text here is 2 Timothy 4, 1 through 5, words that are likely familiar to you if you want to turn with me to that text. 2 Timothy 4, 1 through 5, where Paul writes to his son in the faith these words: I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. So here we have five commands that Paul gives to Timothy. The first one is, preach the word. Preach the word. This is the word of God, namely the gospel of Jesus Christ. When you see the word preach in Scripture, it's most often associated with the saving gospel. Not so much with the instruction and the correction that we think of as a big part of our preaching and teaching. That would be more in the teaching realm. But the preaching is that which really revolves around the content of the message of Jesus' sinless life, his complete fulfillment of the whole law of God, down to the very last and finest detail, his substitutionary death on the cross for the sins of the world, specifically bearing the penalty for all those who repent and believe on his name, his bodily resurrection, which demonstrates his victory over sin, death, hell, and the grave, and becoming the first fruits of that resurrection for us. And then his bodily ascension back to the Father, from where he will one day return to judge the living and the dead. My question is, will you be prepared to meet him? I trust that you will. I pray that you will. So he says, preach the word. And then he says, be ready. This is the second command. The King James says, be instant. Instant. That carries the idea of being prepared at every moment. Not having one moment go by that you're not prepared, he says to Timothy, to preach that word. When it's convenient and when it isn't. In season and out of season. And then he gives three short commands. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort. He's not saying three separate things here so much as he is reinforcing this corrective and instructive preaching and teaching. Stop doing this, do that. Stop doing this, do that. Even the instructive and corrective preaching, though, is built upon what? It's built upon the good news that Jesus has won our victory and has fulfilled the obedience to all those commands so that when we are in Christ, that is how we are seen by God. So how is this reproving and rebuking and exhorting to be done? What does he say? With what? All, can you say it with me? Patience. Patience. Just trying to see how patient you all are with me this morning. 5 seconds, 10 seconds goes by in a sermon, and everybody begins to wonder, what's wrong? Did he forget his train of thought? Possibly. But that was on purpose. With all patience and, interestingly, teaching. Teaching. In other words, don't just rebuke, but give the explanation for the rebuke. Give the reason for the rebuke. Don't just reprove and exhort, but build it up with reasons and scripture and do that with patience. It's to be done this way, the explaining of the truth and the application of it. Sometimes with multiple illustrations, sometimes multiple times. You know, did you get the lesson the first time you heard it? Let's just think about math. Did you get your arithmetic lessons the first time you heard them? No. You had to be taught again and again with drill and practice. It's a little bit the same way with the Christian life. So he answers the question of why in verses 3 and 4. Why? Because this, the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, sound doctrine, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths, stories, tales. You know, if you can tell a good story, you can draw a crowd. If you can spin a yarn, you can draw a crowd. Just ask Joseph Smith. That was his primary gift in building up the Mormon church. He told a believable story. And he spun some really fantastic yarns. He almost was a subscriber to the idea, and believe me, if this is something that's in your background or family or whatever, I'm not disparaging that so much as to say that the bigger the yarn, the more people will believe it, oftentimes. Just make it bigger and they'll believe it. So a secondary text, in addition to this one in 2 Timothy that we should look at, is Galatians 1:8. You don't have to turn over there, but Galatians 1:8 says, "But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to the one we preached to you, let him be accursed." That little word is anathema, meaning cut off. Cut off from Christ. Cut off from the blessings of God. This verse highlights the importance of preaching an undistorted gospel. An undistorted gospel, whether it be by the apostle himself or an angel or anyone. He says, don't buy those who preach a distorted gospel. Let the gospel be kept pure. Let the gospel be kept unadorned. Let the gospel be kept undistorted. And if this doesn't happen, the Holy Spirit says, the one who distorts the gospel for its hearers is to be considered anathema, that is, accursed. So the first mark for us is really without controversy. It's the pure preaching of the Word of God. The second mark is also without controversy, the pure administration of baptism and the Lord's Supper. It seems hardly worth repeating here that we believe in baptism. If we raise the screen That's my only gripe about a screen, you know? It covers up the baptistry. We stand here with the symbols of our faith, the Lord's table, the pulpit, and the baptistry behind us to show these very things, the pure preaching of the Word of God, how central it is to the life of the church, the ordinances of baptism and the Lord's Supper, and how central they are to the life of the church. And so we have this second mark, the pure administration of baptism and the Lord's Supper. Jesus commanded his disciples to make disciples. We see that in Matthew 8, 28, 18 through 20. Very familiar verses to us when he said, "All authority is given to me in heaven and in earth. Therefore do what? Go and make disciples," or teach all nations, another place says. But make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all I've commanded you. And behold, I'm with you always to the end of the age. So this act of making disciples involves baptizing them. That's really kind of the initial act. It's the initial rite. It's the thing that you say, okay, you're a believer, you're a Christian, then be baptized as a sign of that, a symbol of that. Teaching them to observe Christ's commands. And one of those commands is to commemorate his death with the Lord's Supper, which is the second ordinance. It's the continuing ordinance. Baptism is the initiating ordinance. The Lord's Supper is the continuing ordinance that looks back on that baptism. It looks back on those vows that you made when you were first a believer. And it says, yes, I'm continuing in this fellowship. Now, Paul describes how the Lord's Supper is to be done in that familiar passage of 1 Corinthians 11, 17 through 34. And we won't read the entire passage, but I think that we can make reference to it. This is a passage that we use most often when we come together to observe the Lord's Supper. And it's what Paul describes as what happened the night that Jesus was betrayed. And in the first part of this, beginning in verse 17, he gives them instructions and he gives them a rebuke because he says, what you're doing when you come to the church, you're not celebrating the Lord's Supper. You're trying to get positioned to eat and to feed your face. You're trying to fill up. So you're not even discerning the Lord's body. You're not even remotely observing the Lord's Supper. And so he gives them the rebuke. But then in verse 23 he says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" And then he gives instructions even on the partaking of the Lord's Supper. Beginning in verse 27, he talks about how it needs to be done in a worthy manner. It shouldn't be done by those who are non-believers. It shouldn't be, if you're not willing to repent and trust Christ, if you've got something that you're keeping back from the Lord, make sure that you're coming clean with that to the Lord and then partake. So there's even a little bit of church discipline there. Now, I just have to say concerning baptism and the Lord's Supper, something that you already know, and that is, well, let me ask it this way. Let me ask the question rather than make the statement. Have Christians agreed wholeheartedly on baptism and the Lord's Supper over the years? No. The minute you begin to see that there's a little bit more out there besides Baptist life, you begin to realize, oh, there are sincere Christians who have differences of opinion on this. We've debated and we've disagreed over many years over the precise meaning and the mode and the proper subject. You know, should it be pouring or sprinkling, or is it only by immersion? We as Baptists believe only by immersion is given in the Scripture. Who's the proper subject? Do we baptize infants or only believers? What does the Scripture say about that? And who's to partake of the Lord's Supper? What does the Scripture say about that? We try to make our practice consistent with the Scripture. And if we find that it isn't, we try to conform it to that. We believe that teaches believer baptism by immersion as a symbol of saving faith. And then partaking of the Lord's Supper, the bread and the cup, those elements as emblems of Jesus' body and blood, broken and shed for us and given for us and for our salvation. We treat them with great care. We treasure the opportunities we have when we come to the waters of baptism because we recognize how significant it is. We treasure the time that we have when we come to the Lord's Supper because we recognize how significant it is. We don't want to let much time go by. In fact, I remember Chuck Swindoll saying this, if in partaking of the Lord's Supper, you forgot the last time you partook of it, it probably has not been frequently enough. And so there's that sense of remembering from time to time what Christ has done and remembering what's happened since the last time you were at the Lord's table. We practice charity with those sincere Christians of different denominations and different stripes, those who differ with us on these matters. We extend Christian charity to them. We don't go around, for example, I don't go down to the Presbyterian Church or the Methodist Church and say, hey, y'all are doing it wrong. I'm placing you under discipline now. You can no longer do it. That would be wrong, wouldn't it? We believe in congregational government. That's a Baptist distinctive. We don't believe in going to other places and saying, hey, this is the way you're supposed to do it. That's up to the congregation on those things that are disputable. But that brings us to the third mark, and that is the exercise of church discipline for correcting the sins and faults of its members. Now, I've given you two marks that are absolutely without controversy, I think, in our place today. If you have a controversy over the pure preaching of the Word of God and the administration of the elements of the Lord of baptism and the Lord's Supper, then we should probably talk about that. But when it comes to this third mark, the exercise of church discipline for correcting the sins and faults of its members, this is the part at which I'm no longer convinced that I'm just preaching to the choir. I'm not going to take it as preaching to the already convinced only today. When we come to this third mark, not everyone may be convinced. After all, when it says church discipline, what do you think of when you hear the word discipline? Something positive, right? Boy, what a positive experience that spanking was. I sure learned a lot from that. That's usually not what you say in the moment. In the moment. But as older people, as adults, it's almost like we have this perverse way of looking back with fondness at all the spankings we got. Boy, my dad didn't hold back. My mom didn't hold back. They spanked me when I needed it. I can remember my brother made a yardstick holder in vacation Bible school. And it still hangs on my parents, the threshold of one of their doors. And that was the yardstick that my mother would reach for when it was time to administer discipline. Usually, the mere act of reaching for it caused the behavior to change. So very rarely did she have to. But that emblem was always there. The emblem of discipline. But it's also an emblem of love, is it not? When it comes to discipline, you might hear someone say, well, Pastor, that sounds a lot like judging. Are you talking about judging? Didn't Jesus say, judge not lest you be judged? Matthew 7, verse 1. See, right there in the scripture. Yes, he did. Again, context is key. What is Jesus saying, Matthew 7, 1? Look at the context. With the same judgment that you judge, you will also be judged. What he's saying is, let judgment be without hypocrisy. It's in that same passage that he says, don't try to take the speck out of your brother's eye when you've got a log in your own eye. So what he's saying is, don't judge with unfair or unequal judgment. Judge others in the same way that you would judge yourself and want to be judged. Be willing to submit to the same judgment that you are willing to dispense. So we're going to spend some more time on this topic in the next few weeks. I'm not going to finish it out here. Just want to read some of the passages in Scripture that touch on it. And we're going to work backwards here through these New Testament passages, beginning with 1 Peter 1:16. It's a very simple passage. He said, it's been said, be holy, for I am holy. So corrective discipline always has to do with the holiness of God and God's desire for his people to be holy as he is holy. And then 2 Timothy 3:1-5, the passage that we were just in a few moments ago, or the book that we were in just a few moments ago, listen to what he says. But understand this, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty, for people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the appearance of godliness but denying its power. Avoid such people. Okay? So let that sink in. And the key is, he's writing to the pastor of a church. What he's saying is, there, avoid such people that would seek to tear down the faith, even if when they come into the church. He's talking about those who are coming into the church to teach. And then backing up from there to Galatians 6:1. Galatians 6:1 is perhaps one of the more salient passages on this whole subject of church discipline and how to administer it. What does it say? Brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. So this is how it is to be done. This is how restoration is to be done. It's a reminder that that's the purpose of discipline. And then backing up to 1 Corinthians 5, I won't read this entire passage, but I think it's worth looking at, because this is one of the major passages on this subject. There is sexual immorality going on in the Corinthian church, and Paul says, you must expel the immoral brother who has his father's wife as his own wife. This is a situation of gross immorality. And he says, to do this, deliver this man to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, so that his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord. Well, we don't have time to plumb the depths of what that means, but what he's saying is, it's for the man's spiritual good that you engage in discipline, and that it's a warning to him and to others. And then Matthew 18:15-20 is perhaps one of the most well-known passages. We'll seek to look at this in coming weeks as well. Matthew 18 is probably the place that we go to most often to see what is the pattern for dealing with an offense. If your brother sins against you, verse 15 says, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you've gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. This goes back to how evidence was taken under the law, under the Old Testament times. There had to be two or three witnesses to give credence to that. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. If he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. That's a reference to church discipline, folks. That's not that's what that's about. This whole loosing and binding thing has to do with what the decision of the church is, being bound in heaven and loosed on earth, loosed in heaven, bound on earth, bound in heaven, as much as you can possibly do it. And then he says, again, I say to you, if two of you agree on anything about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. Again, church discipline. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am among them. Again, church discipline is the context there. It's not just about worship in general. We often use it and say, well, two or three gathered here in his name, there I am in the midst of them. He said that specifically related to these disciplinary matters. So all three of these, the preaching, the pure preaching of the word, the administration of the Lord's Supper and baptism, and this corrective discipline, all three of these are discipline in some way. The first two are formative, meaning they shape, God uses them to positively form and shape the lives of those who submit to them. Hopefully there's a benefit to you in becoming a disciple. See how the words discipline and disciple relate to one another? See how that causes you to be a better disciple, a more growing disciple, coming under the Word of God and participating in the ordinances of God. The Word of God is preached in order for the Holy Spirit to draw people to Christ and to set them on the path of discipleship. The ordinance of baptism is administered to identify those who belong to Christ and who are admitted then as members of His visible church. The Lord's Supper is shared by those who are in continuing fellowship with the local church and are not under some corrective discipline by the church. When we fence the table at the Lord's Supper, I will say, this is the table of the Lord, and if you are a baptized believer who's not under the discipline of an evangelical church, a Bible-believing church, then you're welcome to participate. So there's this idea of it all being some form of discipline, but the third mark is not formative or teaching so much as it is corrective. That's where the rebuke and the reprove and the correct come into play. It's bringing someone back into the way, saving that soul from death, according to what James says in the last verse of his little epistle, and exercising that love. The third mark is corrective discipline. And that is the way we most often use the word is in a term of correction. To correct, rebuke, chasten. But what is the goal? The goal is always to secure what? Repentance. And to reconcile that soul to the body and to the Lord, in a sense, and to restore them. The church should always stand ready to restore those members who have gone astray into sin, who have gone astray into false teaching, who have gone astray into wrong attitudes even. That's part of it. So we keep this in mind, that repentance, restoration, and reconciliation, and it's all done in love, need to be the purpose for it. So let me underscore this. The purpose and the goal of corrective discipline is never simply to punish or to exclude or to shun the person under that discipline. Exclusion really is far down the line. After you've tried everything else, after you've done everything else, then there comes that point where you say, treated like a Gentile and tax collector, which means to say treated as an unbeliever. Meaning you evangelize them. You seek to bring the gospel to them. But if that is the goal, if the goal is simply to exclude or to shun, then that is a perversion of corrective discipline. True corrective discipline always has in mind the glory of a holy God. God's holiness, first and foremost. The good of the person coming under that discipline. The good of other Christians as they see the danger of going off into sin. The general welfare and well-being and health of the church as a whole, and the corporate witness of the church in the world. And last but not least, our holiness, as it reflects the holiness of God, is put on display through the acts of discipline and the correction that takes place. So here are the takeaways that I want to share with you this morning. First is this, wherever a true gospel church is found, these marks will be found as well. Pure preaching of the word, pure administration of the ordinances, and corrective discipline in the church, the exercise of corrective discipline. J.L. Dagg, early Southern Baptist theologian, said, "When discipline leaves the church, Christ goes with it." I tend to believe that. These marks, secondly, are given to the church for our good and for God's glory. And thirdly, and this has to be kept in mind, corrective discipline is always for the purpose of restoration and reconciliation. That's just how it goes, how it needs to be. And these are hard words to hear, believe me. They're hard for you to hear. They're hard for me to preach. We've spent 4 years thinking about the day when I will preach that church discipline sermon. And so I trust that you know my heart by this time, that I'm not one to come in guns a-blazing, just
ready to take out the offenders. I hope that you know that. I hope that you know my heart is one of compassion and love and a desire to see God's church be healthy and whole in every possible way. But as we look around, do you realize that we have 300 members of our church? I think it's an even 300. Am I right? I think that was the last number we had. And throughout any given year, we may see 115, 120 of that number. So where is everyone? You know, where are those? Well, we know where some of them are. Some the FBI couldn't find. We laugh. But it's really kind of sad. And so we've taken steps previously to try to at least figure out where people are and to go and seek after those who perhaps have gone astray, who've left, or maybe they've moved away. There's all kinds of reasons for someone not to be here. But the closer the church fellowship can be, the closer the actual membership number can be to the actual attendance, that's a sign of a healthy church. And so part of it is getting to that point as well. Many things to be addressed there. Would you join me in prayer as we come to our conclusion today? Our Father, as we have looked at your word and as we have sought to understand it, Lord, as I've sought to explain it in a way that is understandable and which will be accepted, Lord, we pray that your Holy Spirit will have truly been our teacher today. Take and use these words for us so that your name might be glorified. And Lord, that you might draw to yourself those whom you're calling out of this assembly today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.